Our next panel, titled Unwell, powered by Sage Wellness, is about to begin. Please put your hands together for Director of PR and Brand Engagement, Jessica Pecora. Our next...
Thank you so much for the warm welcome. I am Jessica, the Director of PR and Brand Engagement for Sage Natural Wellness. Been working in the PR and brand space for over 11 years now, and I am so, so excited to be here with you all today. The title of our panel is Unwell, something you know we're all very familiar with, burnout, and how to combat burnout naturally. This panel is going to get a little bit heavy. We're talking about some vulnerable conversations. So if you ever at any time feel like you need to step away, take a beat, please do so. We encourage it. Like I said, we all experience burnout. Raise your hand. Who has experienced burnout? Literally everyone in this room. So again, very excited to be talking about this today because it's something that we can all relate to. So without further ado, let me welcome our panelists. Welcome to the stage, Pauleanna Reed, Monique Shikarchi, and Tej Kane. Welcome, welcome. Thank you for joining me today. Okay, so to kick things off, Pauleanna, we're going to start with you. So you are a celebrity ghostwriter who helps high-profile leaders and doers turn their personal stories into powerful brand assets. So for those that may not know, tell us, what is a ghostwriter?
Sure. Hey, everyone. How are you? Nice to see you. Okay, so I'm a celebrity ghostwriter. And the main word that you should pay attention to is ghost, because your assumption is right. I don't get credit for a lot of the meaningful work that I do. However, the best part of my job is the fact that clients trust me with their legacy. So I get hired to ghostwrite books, keynote speeches, and op-eds for some of the world's most influential and powerful leaders. We're in a time now where high-profile figures are really understanding that in order to change business and policy, they have to change hearts and minds. So when they hire me, they're not just hiring somebody to put pen to paper. They're hiring a strategic thinker. They're hiring an architect. I'm a human diary, a confidant. And so when a client wants to stand on a hot topic or shake the room, I'm the woman they call.
That's incredible. I love that. Before moving into our next question, I just wanted to give a little bit of a trigger warning. Like I mentioned, these conversations will be very vulnerable and we're touching on some very deep topics. So again, if you need to take a step away, please feel free to do so. So Pauleanna, you've been very open and very vulnerable about your past suicide attempts. Can you walk me through that time in your life and what led you to that point?
So I'm a high-functioning CEO and founder with crippling anxiety and depression. I've struggled with my mental health for my entire life. And, you know, people who choose to go that route, oftentimes they don't necessarily want to die. They just want to experience peace and relief. And it just seems like death is the most convenient option. When we're little girls, you know, we are told that we can be anything and everything we want to be. And then we grow up into womanhood, college, high school, and then we're conditioned to believe that we need to be more realistic. And many of us get stuck in that gray area. And because of that gray area is why I spiraled. I've gone through a lot of different things in my life, such as, you know, rape and sexual abuse and physical abuse. And, you know, I grew up with an undiagnosed learning difference. I dropped out of college. There are so many life events that happened to me that I didn't know how to cope. The best thing that could have ever happened was raising my hand and asking for help and talking to my doctor. I've gone through my recovery process over the course of many years, and that looks different for everybody. What works for me may not work for you necessarily, but I try to live my life in a way that exemplifies that second chances do exist, and that where you're at is not where you have to stay, right? The best way that I know how to climb out of any hole that I'm in is gradually. And so what I want you to know is that you also hold the pen to write your own story. You can hit the reset button anytime, as many times as you want to, but you have to believe in your heart that there's more out there for you. And sometimes, you know, it requires conversations with yourself, and it's those conversations with ourselves that determine whether we win or lose at this game. I still fight voices inside my head that most people will never understand, but I have to take things day by day, and I know that every slow and shaky step forward is worth taking.
Thank you so much, Pauleanna, for your vulnerability, and thank you so much for sharing that with us today. I know, you know, a lot of us get into that point where we feel really stuck and don't know the way out, so we really appreciate hearing from your experiences. Given everything that you've been through, what allowed you to continue on a path of more peace? Are there certain practices that you stand by and that you would suggest? Like, do you meditate? Do you have mentorship?
So, I mean, I think everybody in this room should have a therapist. Therapy is not just for times when you are struggling with your mental health. It's preventative measures as well. Me and my therapist, we be kikiing on Zoom all the time. Like, we have a great time talking to one another. You know, music therapy, physical activity, creative arts. There's so many avenues and so many things that are available to us, but sometimes I don't think we raise our hand and ask those questions. Everyone's recovery process is going to be very different. The best thing that I did for my team, because I run an agency, is I hired, how many of you have seen Billions? Do you remember Wendy Rhodes? I hired a Wendy Rhodes for my team. I hired someone that they can talk to outside of me where they can vent so that they can be at their highest level of productivity. And I think those of you who are founders and have teams, I think it's very important for us to invest in mental health initiatives so that as a collective, we can make more money, be more productive, and, you know, get everything that we're deserving of.
That's amazing. I love that. And I think that just is such a huge testament to who you are as a leader that you provide that for your team. I think that's amazing. So how do you build trust and rapport with yourself? So in order to prove to yourself anything that you want to do or want to achieve really is possible.
Celebrating small wins, I think, is the best bet. And also understanding, like, if you look back on your life, there's several instances where you've seen God show up for you. There's several instances where a girlfriend has shown up for you. And so, like, that reinforces to me what's possible moving forward.
Well, thank you so much, Pauleanna, for your openness today. We thoroughly appreciate hearing from all of your experiences. Okay, moving on to Tej. Tej, you were born and raised just outside of Vancouver, recently moved to the Greater Toronto Area to pursue a new role as the tourism manager at the City of Mississauga. I would love for you to openly share your struggles with us, the struggles you face when you move here, and how it's impacted your soul and your well-being.
Thank you so much, Jessica. And firstly, welcome everyone to Mississauga. You are in a fantastic city. And so, yes, I moved here at the age of 37. All I had ever known was this small city just outside of Vancouver. I was born and raised there. And at that time, I was really dealing with some mental health issues, really felt stuck, needed a bit of a change. And then my father passed away. And that really kind of spiraled me even further into seeking that change and kind of building a brand new kind of life for myself. And this opportunity with the City of Mississauga came up, and packed my bags with the blessing of my mother, who's in the crowd tonight. So hi, Mom, thanks for being here today, all the way from Vancouver. Packed my bags and came to Mississauga in this brand new role here to build new relationships and to meet new coworkers. And there was just a lot of transition, and I was already at a low point in my life, but the City of Mississauga saw something in me that I didn't at that time even see in myself. And so I had to prove it to myself to come here, and it's taken me 5 years to get to where I'm at, but those struggles were, you know, finding that type of stability and making those new connections and just trying to fit in. And that was something that was really difficult at the time, where I wasn't myself. I wasn't who I was. I was burnt out. I was everything for everyone back home, which I love everyone dearly, but I was always on, always on, and I just needed to turn off a little bit. So when I got this opportunity, it was really doing a lot of self-reflection and setting my boundaries and my new direction and that reset that we just spoke about.
So being South Asian, you have predominantly been a minority in your career path, normally held by white folks. As a lot of women, specifically women of color, feel that they stick out or are the odd ones in certain environments. How has this impacted how you view yourself and how you view others?
So I've been fortunate that I haven't had many cases where I do feel odd or awkward in situations, but I have gotten what I call brown girl confusion. And those that know what I'm talking about is when they think that you're another brown girl. So they're like, oh, hey, Rena. Oh, hey, Karen. Hey, Ruby. And it's like, nope, my name's Tej. And then they'll say it again the next day and, you know, three strikes, you're out. Like, if you don't know my name or if you don't know me by now, I'm really not going to give you my energy or my time. But for the most part, there have been times where I have been in a boardroom surrounded by Caucasian males of an age, a certain age demographic. And, you know, when I first started my career, which was at the age of 25, they were taking bets on how long I was going to last because I was this young person of color, female, in this new role, trying to build up the portfolio over at this, in the city that I grew up in. And I outlasted all of them. I mean, they're still alive, thank you, but I still outlasted all of them. And, you know, you just have to kind of remind yourself that I don't need to prove myself to these individuals. You know you are capable and competent to do your job and do that well. And if you ever feel that you don't feel welcomed or you're not feeling like yourself, then you just got to change that world that you're around. Change the people that you're around. And sometimes an old way of thinking offers you a new way of thinking. And that's when you need to surround yourself by people that are going to be of change and of influence and really start to you know, create that spark and help you move forward and achieve similar goals as well too.
Absolutely. And that's why I love days like today where you just surround yourself with like-minded women who are lifting each other up. I think it's so important, and I'm so happy that you touched on that. So after trying to build your new family, like you said, you came here from just outside of Vancouver all the way to the GTA. You're starting from scratch, basically. You're building a new family, a new network, a new home, really, in Mississauga. What has driven you to your lowest point?
Probably putting myself on Bumble in the GTA. Boy, some of these guys here in the GTA. I'm kidding. Well, kind of not, actually. But no. You know, for me, I felt like I was a bit of a gypsy in the GTA. I've moved 8 times in the last 6 years. I lived in Mississauga, I lived in Brampton, I lived downtown Toronto, and now I finally settled in Etobicoke. And again, it took me a while to get there, but really at that point, I needed stability. I had 1 foot in BC, 1 foot here in Ontario, and I needed to make that decision where I'm going to invest my time and my energy and my growth. And this new learning. And, you know, this is where I want to be. This is where I'm meant to be. The universe is clearly giving me this amazing opportunity as a South Asian female to really help build something special here in Mississauga. And for me, it was, you know, I arrived at my lowest point. There was a few times where that point even got further, like I had hit a few more lower points after that, but it's just building yourself back up and reminding yourself that you are of value, you have worth, and you can really get through anything because we are fearless, we are strong, and we're resilient as women.
Well, I think I can speak for all of Mississauga when I say we're so happy you're here. Now, the word trauma can be very subjective. We've all experienced traumas in different areas of our life. Moving from one place to another can be traumatic, and trauma can result in feelings of depression and anxiety, like you mentioned you experienced yourself. So how have you coped with that depression and anxiety, and what would be a few key takeaways for those that are dealing with something similar?
Absolutely. Back in 2017, I had my first panic attack. I didn't know what was going on with me, and this was back in BC. And I realized at that time something was happening in my body, something was happening in my mind that I could not control anymore. So I immediately went and saw a doctor and got therapy. I went on medication. And throughout this journey that I've been on, I've had to really look inwards and kind of almost reverse engineer myself and start doing the proper healing work and the energy work, and also setting those boundaries. Boundaries is so important. I really needed to kind of do a real rethink of who I am, where I'm going, and where I was. And it's so important to be reminded and do those opportunities where you are doing that self-reflection. Surround yourself by, you know, people that are going to uplift you. I have an incredible family. I am so blessed to have 3 sisters and a brother, a beautiful mother, and my father, who's really helped us grow and achieve and let us know that you can achieve anything. I also have a great supportive friends network, and, you know, that's something that was really tough for me to build here, but I have a great friend that's in the crowd right now, and you know, she's been by my side since the day I moved here. And I also have a great employer, and that's something that, you know, we need to make sure that where we are, where we put our energy and our worth, that we are being appreciated and understood, and that compassion is there. And so I do want to give a shout out to the wonderful Victoria Clark, CEO of Visit Mississauga. She has been instrumental in just making sure that we are doing okay, and that, you know, we do have bad days and we do have good days. And one of the things that I continue to remind myself is that I'm having more good days than bad days. And that's something that when you do have a bad day, it's okay. It is okay to have those bad days. You just have to accept it for what it is and just know that things are gonna turn around and that you will have better days ahead.
I think that's so important that you touched on that, because, you know, I've experienced something similar, and I saw something recently that resonated with me. And, you know, 100% doesn't always look like a straight line at the top. 100% goes in waves, and maybe you're giving 80% one day, but maybe another day 40% is all you can give. And it's so important that that is okay. So thank you so much, Tej. We really appreciated everything
Thanks.
You had to share today. Okay, Monique, talk to me. Who is Monique?
Such a good question. Well, hi everyone, good afternoon. I'm Monique Shikarchi, and I've been thinking about this question quite some time, and the reason for that is because I'm in this space of like evolution. So I'm like rediscovering who I am. I have 4 kids. 2 of them are like adults, and 1 thinks he's an adult, the other thinks she's an adult. So, you know, through all that space, but I've been a mom longer than I've been Monique. So I'm trying to discover who I am. But on title, I'm the Key Cities Marketing Manager for Lululemon in Toronto. And then my passion and my hustle is I'm Mob Seafood CEO, owner, and yeah, restaurateur, all that stuff.
Love that. If anyone hasn't tried Mob Seafood, you need to try it. It is amazing.
Thank you.
So you're a mom, Key Cities manager at Lululemon, the owner of a delicious food truck. Mm-hmm. If that doesn't sound like a lot of work and what burnout might feel like, I really don't know what does.
Yes.
So definitely. Walk me through it. What does burnout feel like to you or look like to you? And how do you identify that feeling when it starts to creep up?
Yeah, burnout feels like I just can't. So like I've had many moments where I'm in the truck and I'm like on this high from, you know, doing the thing in the truck, and it hits like a, yeah, it just
like
hits
a truck.
You like a truck. And you're like, I just can't do it anymore. Or you have a meeting, you have to present, you've been creating this deck for about 8 hours, your time comes, and you're like, I don't even know what I'm saying right now. You know, like it just hits, like you can't deny it. And I think what I'm recognizing now is like those moments are not to be ignored. I've had a lot of women in my life, and I lost my mom in 2019. She did all the things for all the people all the time, but passed away at 65. Then the mother who took care of me as well, second mom, passed away at 59. Like, I'm just realizing this trajectory of like women not sustaining life expectancy past the age of 60 in my life. And I'm like, wow, if I don't pay attention to these moments, I don't know if I'll be here for the moments with my kids that are the most important to me. So I'm really trying to like listen to that voice more often than not.
Yeah, absolutely. You need to listen to your body, listen to what it's telling you, and like really focus on you and take a step back, right?
Absolutely.
And on that note, let's talk about the B word, the big B, boundaries.
I love
that. Yes. Setting boundaries, the idea of saying no, something truly that I personally struggle with and something that I know a lot of people struggle with in general. Would you consider yourself a yes woman, or are you able to set those boundaries and avoid burnout when you can?
I am definitely a yes woman, but I've been learning to say no quite often. So like since joining Lululemon, I do understand they've taught a lot, you know, to us as employees as to take care of yourself and how to recognize certain things within you. And I think for me, the boundaries part has really come up because I just realize I'm tired of people walking over me. I'm really tired of like bending over backwards for certain instances, and it's not serving me. That's the biggest thing I think for me is like understanding that my peace is very important and I need to one, find it. And then when I do find it, protect it. You know, it's kind of like it's everybody says, oh, I want peace. I want peace. And sometimes it's kind of hard to find that peace. So when I do get it, I protect it. So whether it be I'm a huge like old Grey's Anatomy Scandal fan, so I will rewatch. Yes, thank you. I rewatch those, and I'm literally like, don't talk to me for 2 hours. The kids know, don't talk to her from 9 to 11, and I'm dead serious. Leave me alone. And by the time, you know, if unless we're bleeding, there's no need to interrupt that time. So like, whether it be to like set it at home and at work, because I do have to cut off in order to make time for both Mob Seafood and my job. Mm-hmm. I literally have a timestamp as to like, okay, it's 5 p.m. We're done on Lulu, and now we move to Mob, and that's till about 9, and then we're good.
Awesome. So, I mean, you mentioned protecting your peace. Why is that important to you? And what other practices have you done in your life that help you protect that peace? Like, are there any other little things that you do to make sure you're kind of checking in with yourself?
Yeah, I think the what I've started to do this year specifically is actually invest in working out. Like, it first I was like, this workout thing is, you guys talking, whatever. But now what I do notice is when I do go to the gym, I'm a lot more clear. So like by the time I put little man on the bus, I go straight to the gym, workout, and then go back to meetings. I find I'm like functioning way higher at work, and I'm actually able to sleep because I don't know about anybody else, but past 40, the sleep is just not the same.
Non-existent.
Yeah, and so like where I was like 8 hours, I'm getting like 6. And so at least if I'm working out, I'm able to sleep more. So that, and protecting the peace for me is really just, it's important. Like that moment when I know the anxiety's high and I feel it, I can feel it in my body. I'm not showing up 100%. I'll take that minute. I'm like, you know what? And my husband laughs at me all the time, but I go in my closet. Try it. I go in my closet, I turn off the light, Lisa, you know, I turn off the light and I'm just like, just leave me alone. I just need to be in a space by myself, as small or as big as it is.
Yeah.
And I feel much better. It's like a reset for me. So yeah.
Those resets are important.
Yeah.
So you've mentioned, you know, how you set boundaries at work and how you set boundaries at home. For me, I really struggle with the guilt of not giving attention to all of those areas. So my work, my partner, my family, my friends, you know, having to give 100% in all of those areas of my life, it feels really impossible sometimes. And, you know, that's usually when I find myself burning out or burning the candle at both ends because I really want to give that 100%. So how do you manage to prioritize all of those different things in your life, all of the competing responsibilities without feeling that guilt that creeps up that many of us feel?
Yeah, the guilt is real. I can't ignore it. But what I do try to do is like, I'll try to make up for it in different ways. So especially from work, I travel quite a bit now and or have events. And so if I'm away from home, I'm like, listen, you pick the most fun thing and it's like our time. That's with the kids. Husband, definitely been trying to prioritize, but we now start going to the gym together. So that helps a lot. And then for me, I just buy myself something nice because I think
that is the key.
Yeah, I think I deserve it, and I think she's important, so we give her a treat every now and then.
We all deserve it.
Yeah.
We all deserve it.
Well, thank you so much, Monique, and thank you so much to all of our panelists today for the incredible chat. I would love to close by sharing with all of you a mindful practice that is really near and dear to me, and it's something that I use as a moment of grounding when I feel a sense of overwhelm. So it's called a sage breath. Now, you all would have received the little reflection roll-on. If you want to just open that up, and I can guide everyone in a sage breath. So you're going to take your roll-on. I'll explain it first, and then I'll do it along with you. You're going to take your roll-on. You're going to rub it on the palm of your hand. You're going to rub your palms together to heat up the oil, and then you're going to cup your hand over your nose and mouth and do three really big inhales.